morning and welcome to Glad Tidings. We hope that in this next little while, you are able to connect with God, worship Him where you are at home, sing His praises, allow God's presence to be in your mind and experienced in your heart. We're going to read the Word together. We're going to pray together. We are going to hear from God's Word, and we're going to sing together. So let's do that right away as Randy leads us.
Today I choose to follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live.
Roaring with power and fire.
fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Up the gates, make way before the King of Kings, the God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord. And our God is the Lion of Judah, and He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. And our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Yeah, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
Things you have done. I will be filled with joy because of you. I will sing praises to your name, O Most High. But the Lord reigns forever, executing judgment from his throne. He will judge the world with justice and rule the nations with fairness. The Lord is a shelter for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble. Those who know your name trust in you. For you, O Lord, do not abandon those who search for you. Sing praises to the Lord who reigns in Jerusalem. Tell the world about his unforgettable deeds. For he who avenges murder cares for the helpless. He does not ignore the cries of those who suffer. Lord, have mercy on me. See how my enemies torment me. Snatch me back from the jaws of death. Save me so I can praise you publicly at Jerusalem's gates. So I can rejoice that you have rescued me. The wicked will go down to the grave. This is the fate of all the nations who ignore God. But the needy will not be ignored forever. The hopes of the poor will not always be crushed. Arise, O Lord. Do not let mere mortals defy you. Judge the nations. Make them tremble in fear, O Lord. Let the nations know they are merely human.
Yeah.
salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me.
Into this 21 days of prayer, we just want to declare that our hope and our trust is rooted in you. Lord, we come to you, Lord, out of a heart that is trusting in you and trying not to lean on our own understanding, trying not to figure things out, as, Lord, things are very complicated these days. But God, we know that as we lean into you and we trust in your promises and we come to know you better, that God, you will work on our behalf. God, you're faithful. And we pray with that in our heart. We bring our request to you knowing that, God, you have already overcome the world, Lord. And so, Lord, we want to come and pray in the place, Lord, between what is happening, what we see in the natural, and the promises that we have from you. We stand in that gap, Lord, right now. We stand in the gap and we pray, Lord, pulling upon the promises that, God, you will work all things to good for those that love you and are called according to your purposes. Lord, we reach out to you today, and we ask you, God, on behalf of all the leaders of our nation, God. Lord, both at the federal level, the provincial level, and the local level. Lord, all the people who are making decisions today regarding, Lord, the pandemic, and Lord, all the health issues and all the issues surrounding the safety and protection of people in the land of Canada. God, we pray that their hearts, Lord, those leaders, God, would not lean only on their own education and their own research and their own knowledge, but God, somehow those that don't even know you would just cry out, even to an unknown God, Lord, that they would just cry out for help, for clarity, for wisdom, for answers as they lead the people and make decisions about our future. Lord, we pray for them personally, every one of them, from our prime minister to every local leader, Lord, across our land. And Lord, for even all the healthcare workers, Lord, especially those doctors and nurses and those that help in ICU units across our land and in the province of Ontario right now, God, in this crisis. We pray, God, that they would not give over to fear, that they would not give over to the stress and the strain of the situation. But God, you would lift them up and you would comfort them, Holy Spirit, and you would give them protection. Give them your thoughts, God. God, we ask this. We know that this is, God, a supernatural thing that we are asking for, that you would pour out your spirit upon our land, that you would pour out your spirit upon these leaders, and you would give them divine wisdom and guidance. Lord, we pray for the leaders of churches across our land that, God, are facing such complexities these days. And Lord, so unsure of which way to go and what to do. We pray for them. We pray for safety for them. We pray for protection. We pray for provision, heavenly provision for all of our needs, Lord. Lord, we pray for the children of our nation. We pray for all those, Lord, who are afraid. Lord, those that don't have answers. They just don't know where to turn. Lord, for the children that are growing up in a very complex situation right now, we pray, God, that you would give their parents peace, that anxiety and stress would not overcome them, and that, Lord, they would be able to have peace in their home. And, Lord, that, God, our youth, our young people, our children would not lose hope. You are the God of hope, and we pray that you would give us your body, your people. Give us supernatural wisdom. Give us ideas. And Lord, give us the passion to pray for our neighbors and to pray for our family. Lord, give us ideas of how to reach out to them, even with all the regulations and restrictions, God. Give us divine ideas of how to reach out with the love of God. And Lord, help us to not just be thinking about ourselves and how we can make it through this time, but God, that we would look at this time as the most, the greatest opportunity for you, God, to show up on the scene and to pour out your spirit upon our land and to, Lord, reveal yourself to people. We pray for encounters, that people would encounter you, that we would hear those testimonies of people that didn't even know you, but God, you touched them in a very unique way, and they came to a place of believing in you and trusting in you. So we pray for a great, just a harvest of souls in our nation. Lord, we pray that this would be the time. We sense, oh God, how short time is. And Lord, even in this time, God, we ourselves are feeling, your body is feeling stressed at times. So I pray for every believer that we would be able to still ourselves before you and that we would hear your voice clearly. Jesus, you said, my sheep hear my voice. So Lord, we just come and we dial down the chaos and the noise of our culture, Lord, and the many conflicting voices, we dial it down and we still ourselves before you so that you can speak to us. And Lord, we not only want to hear you, but Lord, we will heed your voice because we know you will show us what to do. You are faithful, we trust you, and we look to you with confidence, with confident expectation of you doing what only you can do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Have you ever used gap filler? That's that spray for, you buy a can, you turn it upside down, you press the nozzle and foam comes out and it goes from just a little thing to, and it fills the gap. It goes from side to side between the window and the wood or between the, you know, cracks in the concrete or whatever you got. It just fills the gaps. It's a gap filler. Have you ever heard the phrase, and I'm sure you have, stand in the gap? Well, you know, kind of exactly like what that gap filler does. You're standing in the gap. You're going from side to side with, you know, immovable things on both sides, and you're filling in that gap. The phrase dictionary says that stand in the gap means to expose oneself to the protection of something, to make difference against an assailing danger, to take place of a fallen defender or a supporter. So in other words, it means to mediate between two things. It means to forge a connection. It means to fill a void. It means to step up into. So this is a concept that is not at all foreign in Scripture. Ezekiel. This morning we're going to look at Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30. It says, God is speaking here through the prophet and speaking about the events that have taken place in Israel. Israel has gone into exile, both the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. And Ezekiel 22, verse 30 says this, I looked for someone among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land so I would not have to destroy it. But I found no one. Those are the words of God. The wall in this scripture is Jerusalem's wall, the wall around Jerusalem. And there was a gap through the wall which people could freely come and go through. However, the same gap is a security risk. People could freely come and go, but so could an enemy. And the wall, in Bible times, in the ancient world, walls were one of the best ways of protection for a city or a community. And so if there was this gap, if it was not tended to or gated in some way, the enemy could easily come through, occupy, or conquer the city. So Jerusalem, the prophet is saying, was at a place where there were gaps in the wall, and God could find no one to fill it. So Jerusalem was vulnerable. Now in this case, the prophet was speaking of a gap in a spiritual wall around Jerusalem's heart. The people had left God's way for their own. As you read the full chapter, you find a list of sins they committed that they had not repented of. As punishment for Israel's sins, God says in verse 15, he will scatter them around the world. This is what it says. I will despise you among the nations and scatter you through the countries, and I will put an end to your uncleanness. So now back to verse 30. There was a gap in which represented the danger Jerusalem was facing because of their sin. Judgment was sure to fall on them if they didn't shore up the wall, if they didn't repent. Here's the thing. If there would have been someone to stand in the gap for Jerusalem and intercede, they would have repented and found forgiveness and been kept from judgment. Now, that's not the only story with a gap and someone standing in the gap. There are other examples in scriptures of people who did stand in the gap when God was able to find someone. For instance, Moses did it. A song was written about him that unfolded, about a story that unfolded in Exodus. And it was by the psalmist who wrote in Psalm 106. A psalm, it summarizes the sins of Israel in the wilderness and primarily the golden calf incident. And so Psalm 106, verse 23, explains. So God said he would destroy them, had not Moses, his chosen one, stood in the breach before him to keep his wrath from destroying them. Moses held the breach. He stood in the gap and saved the people of Israel with his petition on their behalf. In standing in the gap, he prayed for God's people. He stood between the people and God. And I believe Moses was chosen for this purpose as a forerunner to the priests who would be later appointed to that very task. Because the Old Testament priest was defined as one who stood between God and his people. So Moses was one man who stood in the gap. Jonah was another one. It happened in this case for the city of Nineveh. And we find this story in the book of Jonah, where the city of Nineveh was wicked before God. Their sin was great, but after a self-imposed trial because of disobedience, Jonah went to Nineveh and preached. And when he preached, he saw revival. People repented of their sin, and they turned to God. Jonah stood in the gap for that city. That city was going to face God's judgment because of their wickedness, but God sent this man to preach his love. And they repented. Stephen, in the New Testament, in the book of Acts, in chapter 7, we see a man who is being stoned to death because of the message that he preached against the ruling religious Jewish leaders of the day. As they were throwing stones at him, he stood in the gap and prayed for his accusers. Acts 7, 59 to 60 says this, while they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he fell asleep. So he stood in the gap between these people and their sin before God. Paul was another one. He prayed for Israel's salvation. He wanted the Jewish people to know the salvation that came to them through Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 10, verse 1, he says this, brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and prayer to God is for the Israelites, is that they may be saved. Standing in the gap involves more than just standing there filling the space. In most of the situations I just referred to, people actually prayed. They stood in the gap and they prayed. The best way to stand in the gap is with prayer. To stand in the gap is to intercede and to plead for God's mercy. Now, as you are aware from my word of encouragement in Thursday's update newsletter, I believe God is leading us as a church into 21 days of prayer. And beginning today, for the next 21 days, I'm asking you to join with Lydia and I to stand in the gap against COVID-19 and its effects on us and our community. We need to do as Moses did and plead for God's mercy. Well, we aren't going to be asking for God to hold back his wrath because of our sin. We are going to be asking him to show us his mercy. Let's look at the Exodus account that I referred to the story of Moses that was sung in Psalm 106. Let's look at that a little closer. In the original story, Moses stood in the gap and pleaded with God for Israel. This is an interesting prayer. Let's read it together from Exodus 32, verses 9 to 14. I have seen these people, the Lord said to Moses, and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone, so that my anger may burn against them, and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation. But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. Lord, he said, why should your anger burn against your people, whom you brought out of Egypt with this great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger. Relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. Look at what Moses did. He prayed God's promise back to God, asking him to change his mind about the judgment of destroying Israel because of their sin. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, the people you promised this great nation to. If God destroyed Israel, Abraham's offspring, he said to Moses that he would make Moses' offspring a great nation. Well, Moses should have backed away and said, okay, he would have been the beneficiary of this great nation. It would be the name of Moses that we have on the name rather than the name on the nation rather than the name of Abraham. Moses knew there was a breach, a gap, and he had to stand in it for Israel and plead with God on their behalf. Now, a little explaining needs to be done here. The word relent, also translated in some of your versions of the Bible, repent, or some versions even say God changed his mind, in this passage doesn't mean that God changed his mind as we change our mind when we're selecting ice cream. Oh, I want blueberry. No, I want rocky road. No, I want vanilla. No, that's not what this means. Because if that's what it means we have a God who changes. One day he judges sin, and the next day he doesn't judge sin. It would seem that that's what it would be like. You don't want to catch him on a bad day if that were the case. But that's not the way our God is. Our God is consistent. He never changes. The meaning that word relent or repent carries in the original language is that of God comforting himself or God satisfying himself, or his just requirements were met. He was satisfied with the measures that would be taken on earth to turn his wrath away from Israel because of their sin. So let me say that again. He was satisfied with the measures that would be taken on earth to turn his wrath away from Israel because of their sin. What measures happened on earth? Moses prayed. He pleaded with God to relent. And God was satisfied with Moses' request, standing in the gap for his people. He was standing between earth and heaven, between his people and God. So God extended mercy on them. In essence, Moses was saying, okay, now this is a Lewis huge paraphrase, but okay, God, give me a chance with these people. Just trust me a little bit longer. Their hearts will change. And God did. He trusted Moses with them. But if you know the story of the Israelite people in the Old Testament, you know that they continued to complain and rebel against God for generations until there was no sign on earth of a resolution that would meet God's just demands. Their hearts remained hard. So about 700 years after this incident in Exodus, God carried out his wrath on Israel. And they were scattered to Babylon. They were exiled from the promised land. The kingdom was divided. There were even civil wars. And God's judgment came down because there was no one standing in the gap. And that's where we get the Ezekiel passage. In Ezekiel 22, this is 100 years after that. This is in the midst somewhere of that exiled time. And Ezekiel wrote this prophecy that God could find no one to stand in the gap for Israel and for the sin that they had committed. I say all that to say this. We need to stand in the gap and pray. We need to pray and find God's favor. Seek his mercy. We need to pray and ask him to move the balance of power away from COVID-19. It has wreaked havoc in people's lives. It has affected people in our own church. It has affected people in our community, in Lanark County. It has affected businesses in town, both large businesses, some of the big factories, as well as some of the small, independent, single-owner businesses that are in jeopardy of ever opening up again. It has affected our essential workers in the health, in education areas, in the food service industry, in everywhere. It has affected our construction workers. It has affected so many of our people. It has even affected our governments from local and outward. And you know what? It doesn't do anything to complain about government's decisions or people's actions or what people are doing or not doing. But prayer and standing in the gap does. In Israel's case, it was their sin that created the gap in the wall. But we need to stand in the gap that COVID has created in our world. When God looks at us, will he find, like he did when he spoke through the prophet Ezekiel, that there was no one who stood in the gap? Or will he find us praying, as Moses did, standing in the gap and interceding for our church and our community? Would you please join with Lydia and myself for the next 21 days? Now, as I said in the video on Thursday, you don't need to pray for an hour. I'm not asking you that. What I believe God is asking us to do is to take a few moments and pray each day. Everyone can do this. Stop whatever you're doing at some point in the day and pray for the requests that I send you. Pastor Nathan and I are going to send out this listing. Every day you're going to get something. Or plan a period of time in the day that maybe after your devotions that you could just pray for these requests and stand in the gap for your church family, for your church community, for our area. Intercede. Pray. Plead for mercy. Stand in the gap. Let God know that we need him. Remember this scripture, Philippians 4, verse 6, that says, do not be anxious about anything. Don't be anxious about COVID. But in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Stand in the gap. We need to stand in the gap and pray. Now, besides that, I'm also asking you that if, when we send you this prayer request each day, ask you that you would share it on your social media feeds, whether you're on Facebook or Instagram, Twitter, whatever you're on, share it. Just link to it. Link to our Facebook page on your social media feed. We want to have as many people as possible praying because prayer changes things. So here's the application for this morning's message. Well, first of all, why 21 days? I don't know. That's just what God had impressed upon me. So beginning tomorrow morning, each morning, a prayer request will arrive in your email, in your email inbox, okay? Sometime in that 24-hour period, pray. During the day, take those requests to God every time you think about it. Now, there's not going to be a page of requests every day. I'm going to keep them as short and simple as possible, just one or two lines. But if we all pray, if we stand in the gap, it will be effective. But today actually is the start of the 21 days that we want to do. So for today, I'm going to give you the first request now. And I'm going to ask you, wherever you are in your home, with your family, or if you're alone at home, to pray now. So here is the first prayer request. Pray that God would place the burden in your own heart to pray against the effects of COVID-19 for 21 days. It's a self-serving, great way to start, isn't it? We are going to end this pre-recorded portion of our service in just a moment, and I'm asking you, in your home, with your family, to pray as soon as this ends. So no one has to sit there awkward and say, oh, what do we do now? No, what I'm asking you to do is to pray. However you want to do that, whether you want to go around a circle in your family, have the children or husband and wife pray, however you want to do that, but I'd like you to pray that prayer request that God would place the burden in your heart to pray against the effects of COVID-19 for the next 21 days. Then what we are going to do is we are going to leave This video will come to an end, and we're going to leave the chat open. And I want you, perhaps, maybe you want to type your prayer into the chat. Maybe your prayer might inspire someone else to pray and stand in the gap. So the chat will be open. We'll leave it open for a while so you can just continue to pray. So, this is it. I'm going to ask you to please pray.